In the name of Jesus Christ and on behalf of the Toso family, I welcome you today. We have come to worship God together and to honor Alissa's life, a life that was far shorter than any of us would have liked, and yet a life in which we were all privileged to share. The family's glad and the Lord is glad that you're here. Anytime someone we love leaves us unexpectedly, and especially early in life, the world can seem to close in around you. And it's precisely those times when perspective becomes really, really important. So many in our world today think that days like this mark the end, and they're left without hope. Yet those who follow Jesus are not among the hopeless, because the Christian perspective is longer and it's higher and it's deeper than just what we can see and what we can sense. The Christian perspective is as eternal as God himself. In his second letter to the Christians at Corinth, an ancient letter, we get a glimpse of this eternal perspective in the life of the Apostle Paul. He was reflecting about his own life and many hardships that he faced, troubles and tragedies. But Paul was able to say, while the pains of this life are very real, they are, from an eternal perspective, light and momentary afflictions. That's what he called them. He didn't dismiss them. He didn't say they didn't exist. He didn't say they were not very, very hard to deal with. But he did understand them to be temporary. In fact, he goes on to say that those whose trust is in Jesus can trust him to even use hardships to somehow prepare us for that eternity. God does not cause these tragedies, but neither will he waste them in our lives. So that's why Paul could remind the people of Corinth just as he would remind us today. He said this, he said, "Take heart and set your mind not on the things that are seen, but on the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are temporary, but the things that are unseen are eternal." Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we know that you are here in our midst. You were there at our birth, and you've been there in every chapter of our lives, whether or not we've realized it, whether or not we've recognized you. You've been there just the same, and you're here today. Would you help us in these moments together to give our attention to the things that really matter in life, to you and to the eternity that we all face beyond our days here on earth, so that we can always see the events of this world, whether they're joyful or sorrowful, we can always see them rightly in light of eternity. Would you help us to worship you and to honor Alissa, we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
I wanted to share what Alissa had put on her Facebook. And I wanted to tell you all that your support and prayers really were powerful. Alissa, she was following her devotions, and the devotion, Jesus Calling, she was looking at that, and she, it's talking about how God's face is shining upon you, beaming out peace that transcends understanding. You are surrounded by a sea of problems, but you are face to face with me, your peace. As long as you focus on me, you are safe. If you gaze too long at the myriad problems around you, you will sink under the weight of your burdens. When you start to sink, simply call out, "Help me, Jesus, and I will lift you up." The closer you live to me, the safer you are. Circumstances around you are undulating, and there are treacherous-looking waves in the distance. Fix your eyes on me, the one who never changes. And she posted that, and she wrote, "Jesus loves me. He loved you too." I am so happy that I ran across this morning. I'm great this morning, but sometimes this can play a huge role in my life because of my mental health issues I deal with. Jesus is here for all who will take his hand. And I'm going to read the 23rd Psalm. "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
I would invite you to join me in prayer again, please. Heavenly Father, you have been true to your word. You have walked through the darkest of valleys with us. In all those times, you have brought us comfort. We watched as Alissa walked through dark valleys, many of them of her own making and of her own choosing. We couldn't go there with her. We couldn't walk alongside of her. We couldn't stop her. There was nothing we could do. But there was nothing she could do about you going through those dark places with her either. And even though she may have ignored you, even though she may not have always acknowledged your presence or asked for your help, we know that you were there with her. You brought her through all of those valleys to see another day. We are grateful to you for your continued presence in her life. We thank you for never giving up on her, never walking out on her, and never leaving her alone. Even in her darkest times, you were calling to her, offering to her a better way. Thank you for your faithfulness to her. Thank you for continuing to encourage her to give her heart and her life to you. Because of your amazing grace and your persistence, she did give her life, her heart, and her soul back to you. She trusted you to be the one to see her through whatever else life was going to throw at her. When her health declined and her body began to fail, she trusted you. As she entered that last dark valley where the shadow of death was the darkest, she trusted you. She walked confidently into it, knowing you were holding her hand. She didn't have to fear because you were with her. Today, that dark valley has given way to the brightest light with the most amazing of views, with peace, comfort, and rest. She is eternally yours. She is in your presence forever. Nothing can change that. Father, I pray for Cal, Marilee, Jacob, Luke, Bobby, Josh, and Christopher, and the rest of the family. They miss her dearly. Yet in the midst of their sorrow, there is a deep peace because they know she is with you. Each day, would you renew their assurance of your faithfulness to her? Would you keep alive inside of them the hope that in your good time, they will be together again in that place where pain and sorrow and tragedy don't exist? Until that time, keep them in your good care.
Keep their eyes firmly fixed on you as their Savior and Lord. Keep their faith strong so that when you call them home or when you return, whichever you choose, they will enter into your eternal presence just as Alissa has. May they be reminded often of how sweet that reunion will be. We ask for your goodness and your faithfulness to be made known to this family today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite Cal to come up and give a tribute. And then after he has given his tribute to Alissa, if you have something that you would like to share in regards to her life and what she meant to you and what you learned from her, I invite you to come up here to the pulpit and share that tribute with us as well.
I'd like to thank everybody that came here today, Marilee and Josh and Jacob, Luke and Bobby, and we very much appreciate your presence in celebrating Alissa's life. Alissa is a little girl. She was very pretty. She was very shy, and she was very smart. I mean, she was smarter than whip. There was times where Marilee was teaching Christopher, our oldest, and they were like, what, two and a half years apart, teaching word recognition. And of course, Christopher's stumbling, and Alissa sitting across the table, fit to be tied because she already knew what it was. it went on even towards when they were in high school, where Christopher would be doing some algebra, and Alissa, I think at the time, was in ninth grade. And she's sitting on the side, or maybe eighth grade, I can't remember exactly. But we're in Virginia. And she says, no, Christopher, it's this right here. And I was like, wow. She was smarter than a whip. She loved music. She played clarinet. She played flute. She loved animals. Oh, my goodness. Every time something was coming to the house, it's like, it's not staying, is it? Right? A little bunny, a little dog. One time she nursed a deer, a little baby fawn, back to health. And it was just amazing of her touch that she had with animals. And again, I'm not sure if I mentioned art, but she took some of the traits from her grandma, Hannah, and from Marilee, and can just draw. And I was like, wow. I mean, number one, I can't draw. I can't even trace things, right? But so it didn't come from my family. and then back to music. Oh my goodness! She picked up my guitar, which I don't know how to play. Just had it for years, and would start playing the guitar. She would go to the keyboard of our piano, and she could read music. I'm like, this is phenomenal. This definitely didn't come from the Tosos. It had to come from the Franks. You know, that was pretty neat. About 5 years ago, maybe six, I was going out to my mother's in Las Vegas to celebrate her 80th birthday. I no more than get to Las Vegas when Marilee had called me and said that she had hung herself and that she was not responsive. So quickly, I get back on a plane. I get back to Lexington. But on that plane, I was praying. I was talking to God, saying, oh, please, God, have her be responsive to come back to us. I've never told anybody this, but I said, God, if you need a life, take mine. Before the flight end, I felt a calm. I was at peace. It was about 2 days later that Alissa actually came back to us, which was a miracle. When Bobby had called me and told me that Alissa had passed away, and we prayed. Well, when you first called me, we prayed, but then when you called me and said she passed away, I was a very angry person. I asked God, why through all this, through her battle with drugs, with her battle of alcohol, and now she's got her life back straight. She's found somebody that she really loves, which is Bobby. Why would something like this happen? Well, later on, Mary Lee had told me that Bobby had said that, well, I guess it'd be 8 or 9 months from now, right, that she took Christ back into her heart. And so that morning, I'm driving back to work, still kind of angry, and then it hit me. It was like, wow. She'd been having some problems with mental health. She was having some problems with her health in general. And I don't know this for certain, but after she's taken Christ back into her heart, God asked her to come back home, which to me is definitely a celebration of her life. Through everything that she's been through, the good and the bad, that she actually accepted Jesus again, and it was okay. Again, thank you all for coming. Thank you, Pastor Daryl, Daryl and Dwight. I appreciate the church's support for our family during, many years now. And again, thank you for coming.
Oh, I just want to say one thing. Usually in the Marine Corps, when we retire and that we're going to one of our fallen brothers or sisters, we wear, as a retiree, we wear something like this with our medals. And the reason why I wore this today is because Alissa, even though she wasn't in the service or specifically the Marine, she was part of the Marine. And this is a joint service achievement award. This is something that Alissa had pinned on me on my medal ceremony that the Marines have provided for me. It's something that I had earned over and up in Boston. Well, thank you again. Appreciate you coming.
If anybody else would like to offer tribute, please come on up and offer it at this time.
I'm Aunt Donna, and I had great privilege and honor to be with her and to be with her often. Marilee and I were looking at pictures on the internet and going back into the computer and looking at old pictures that I forgot about. And I thought, oh my gosh. Oh my goodness, I forgot about this and I forgot about that. But, you know, there's been some mention, and it's no secret, everybody knows that Alissa struggled with substance abuse. I feel it's so important for everybody, even the kids here, to get the piece that when people are engaging in substance abuse, people who have mental health issues, I think everybody knows here that she had schizophrenia. We didn't know that for a long time. People who are self-medicating, they're not doing it to get high. They're not doing it to have a great, fun night. They're doing it to be okay in their skin. That's all. And when we look at that, you know, I can see where I might do it. I think any of us, I don't know. None of us here know what it feels like to struggle with that level of mental illness. But I know it's so forgivable. Alissa had a lot of compassion. My son, Bobby, grew up here in this church, so a lot of you might remember him. He has intellectual disability. Alissa always made it a point to reach out to Bobby. My nephew is here today. He has autism. And at the beginning of the service, he was having a hard time. We could all probably hear that. And I thought, you know, I don't believe that anybody that's passed away hears and is watching us, because if they did, they wouldn't be in heaven. Not watching all of us. But if she had a say, she'd say, it's okay. It's okay, Danny. Alissa and I flew to the World Expo on Disability Conference in Philadelphia. And we met my daughter, Jessica, there. And one evening we were walking the streets, you know, just seeing Philadelphia. It happened to be the same night that the Army-Navy people were there. And there was a big ruckus on the road. And we looked down, and there was a man who, he was an amputee. I think he was inebriated, but he was on the ground. And there were a lot of military guys making fun, laughing. And we picked that man up, and we brought him out to eat with us. And Alissa was just so on board with stuff like that. She was also on board to have fun. That same weekend, the Army-Navy ball was occurring in the same hotel where we had our conference. And we had these great big badges for our conference. And when that ball was starting, I had a fun idea. I decided, let's go sneak in the Army-Navy ball. My daughter Jessica stood back. She wasn't going to have any part of that. But Alissa and I got in there. That was fun. Anyway, she was daring, she was fun, she was a good sidekick for me. Sometimes she would rein me in, even though I was the aunt. Every now and then I might go a little too far. Yeah, some of them I won't say here. But she was smart. We flew back home from that Philadelphia trip, and I remember my car, oh my gosh, it was the middle of the night. And we were in Cincinnati Airport, and the tram took us way out to the remote parking. My car was totally iced over. We couldn't figure out how to even get in the car. And that kid opened up her cosmetic bag, and I don't know what she did, but boy, she melted the ice with some stuff. Because she was really smart. She was, yeah. Anyway, I've had the pleasure of being there in not so good time either, but not a pleasure, but an honor to be there all the way around. We're going to miss her. Thanks for coming.
Very understanding. It's going to be a tough one now. I met Alissa when I was together with Mandolin for 22 years, and I was going through some very hard times. I mean, I was sliding down a hill I shouldn't be sliding down. And about 4 months after that happened, my uncle pulls up. He says, "Here's your date for tonight, Bobby." I said, "Howard, I really don't want no date." She goes, "Well, she don't have nowhere else to go." Come and find out the place she was staying at, they was just awful people, just awful people. It was good at first, but then they just slid downhill. So she went to Thanksgiving dinner with us, and she was so sad. She followed me around the whole night. Then that night we was talking. I said, "Well, you can stay at my house. You know, the couch is right there. We got some covers and some blankets." And we stayed up and watched TV and talked. She got mad because I left and I went to the bedroom and fell asleep. And about 3 days after that, she helped me work on my car and I fell in love with her. We fell madly in love with each other. We hunt, we fish. We went all over. We traveled so much in that little short time we was together. And she was the greatest person ever. She had a lot of demons following her around, and that's why she wanted to go. Every time we went somewhere, she said, they're coming after me. I said, "What do you want us to do, Alissa?" She says, "We gotta go, we gotta go now." I listened to everything she said. I'd pack everything up. We'd get in the car and we'd go somewhere else. Then I got the dog, Kratos. He's a security dog. Y'all haven't met him yet, but he's the greatest dog ever. Sweetest kind, but acts mean. Like Alissa. She's sweet and kind, and she acts mean. And when she would train him, they would sit there and argue all day long and bite and argue. And I'm like, look at him and say, "Man, I'm glad I'm not him." But it's the best times of my life. I never felt love before until I met that little girl. But the demons aren't with her now. She's in a better place. So that's about all I can say. Thank y'all.
I'm not going to take long. I just want to tell one story. And this is mostly for Luke and Jacob to hear. I am 6 years older than Alissa. I'm her cousin. I remember when she was born. I like to merrily let me feed her a bottle sometimes. One time I accidentally dropped her. that's not the story. Alissa always really looked up to me. I don't know why she did. Probably because I was 6 years older than her. And we spent all the holidays together, Thanksgiving, you know, every year. Almost every year when we would take a vacation, it was to go visit Marilee, wherever they were living. So that was, you know, we were close. I say that because it's important in the story to understand how much Alissa looked up to me. I didn't have kids yet. I was in my early 20s. And I was driving from Kentucky to North Carolina. My mom was in China, and I was with Bobby. And for whatever reason, we were going to North Carolina to visit my grandmother. Not Alyssa's grandmother, the one that's here, but my grandmother on my dad's side. And I said, "Hey, Alissa, you want to come with me to the mountains? Be fun." And of course, yeah, you know, she loved adventure. She was down for it. So she came, and at the time, my grandmother loved to listen to this daytime radio show that would drive me crazy. And the guy on the radio was always so nasty. And grandma would leave the room and go to the bathroom, and I'd say, "Oh, that's it, I'm turning this off," and I'd turn it off. And then grandma would come back, and, "What happened to my radio station?" And we went out for a walk, and I said, I can't listen to this stuff anymore. It's making me mad. That was the end of it. Well, when we got back from North Carolina, about 2 or 3 days later, I got a phone call. Alissa was very upset that I had turned my grandma's radio off when she wasn't in the room, and that grandma didn't know what was happening. She thought she was losing her mind. Alissa thought I was gaslighting my grandma. At the time, I got really mad at her, and I was like, why didn't you tell me? But I think this story is so important because she really looked up to me, but she had the courage to say, you know what, this happened, and I wasn't comfortable with it, and to talk to her mom about it, and then to talk to me about it, that's bravery. You know, it's easy to if you don't like somebody or if you don't look up to that person, to rat them out. But someone that you're that close with that you really, you know, look up to, I just wanted her boys to hear, you know, she was brave. She did the right thing. She saw something, she didn't like it, and she did the right thing. So if you learn anything from your mom, remember to be brave and to do the right thing.
Hello. She's my favorite cousin in the whole world. I miss her so much. I'm gonna cry. I'm on the team. I'm calling with Jesse and everybody else. That's everybody. I wanted to say, she came here, this church. We pray to God here. I'm so sorry.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. And I will rise when he comes. passing through on my way home. Heaven is the place where I belong. More than just a feeling or a dream, a land beyond the stars is calling me. When the Savior comes for me, I'll go to live forever, finally at home. I've searched the world far and wide, trying to fit in, to find the place where I was meant to be. But I never felt the peace inside I was looking for, until I walked the road to Calvary. Kneeling there, I realized there was so much more than this old world could ever hold for me. I'm only passing through on my way home. Heaven is the place where I belong. More than just a feeling or a dream, a land beyond the stars is calling me. When the Savior comes for me, I'll go to live forever, finally at home. My mind cannot imagine what these eyes will behold. When I reach that land of brilliant light, captured in the moment that I've waited for so long, I will gaze in wonder and delight. And now I keep on traveling this road that leads me home. Soon I'll take my heavenly flight. Passing through on my way home. Heaven is the place where I belong. More than just a feeling or a dream, a land beyond the stars is calling me. When the Savior comes for me, I'll go live forever, finally at home. Days that last forever, night will never come. Over the horizon, there's no setting sun.
Jacob and Luke, I want you to know one thing. Your mommy loved you very much. There are a lot of things that happened in her life that we don't understand, and it's hard for us to make sense of it all. But none of what happened is not because your mommy didn't love you. she did. Many of the battles she fought kept her from showing her love in the way she wanted. Deep in her heart, though, she wanted to be there with you boys. She really wanted to be a good and a strong presence in your life. And none of us can really understand why she couldn't. With you as young men, and me as your friend and your pastor, I want to encourage you to take all your hurt, all your questions, and all your thoughts to Jesus. Talk to him about it, because he wants you to become the best men that you can be. He has good plans for you. And even though your mommy's not here to see what you will become in life, Jesus is, and so are we. We're eager to see what he has planned for you and how he wants to use you in this world. We know he wants to use you to do good and wonderful things for him and for your family and for the world. And Cal, I was in the hospital that night when they said she has no brain activity. But Jesus was there. I left with the question, was that me, or did I sense something special? And I couldn't believe, God forgive me for my weak faith, but I couldn't believe what I heard the next morning. All praise to Jesus. Friends, life is full of surprising twists and turns. Some are good and exciting. Some are sombering and challenging. And as you read through Alyssa's obituary, which Mary Lee has so beautifully written, you notice that Alyssa had talent given to her by God. She was intrigued by what he had created. The mystery of the outdoors was her friend. Her mind chased the wonders he had placed in this world through the gift of music. He placed within her a compassion, his compassion, so that she saw the hurting and the needy people through his eyes. He gifted her with a giving heart and a mechanically intrigued mind. A wonderful girl. A beautiful gift. Someone who blessed others with that with which God had blessed her. We never know exactly what causes a person to leave what seems to be an exquisite journey of following God's plan so that they can stumble through the brambles and the briars of trouble as they try to find a better way. But they do. We all do. In our own way, we do it, some more noticeable than others. And at one time or another, every one of us has left the ways that we know we should walk. We leave those paths in search of something new. We choose a different path in search of the ever-elusive promise of something more enticing. In chasing down those mirages of promises, we have caused others to worry about what we are doing and who we are becoming. Each of us sitting here know that without the unending grace and mercy of our ever-loving Heavenly Father, our stories would be way different than what they are today. Because of His unending mercy and grace, and in spite of all the heartache and pain that fills us today, we can rejoice and celebrate. It's no secret that Satan's plan for each of us is to destroy our bodies in this life and our souls in the next. He wants to bring us heartache in this life, and he wants to bring us sorrow through death. But through the power of Christ's death and resurrection, all of Satan's plans have been thwarted. What Satan works to mess up in this life, Christ died to forgive and redeem. He uses all of our failures, all of our wanderings to make us better people, to help us more powerfully impact the lives of others. Satan wants to use death as an assault on humanity and an insult to God. But Christ has turned that insult and that assault into a passageway to eternal life. Through that passageway, he places us in the presence of God. For the followers of Jesus, what Satan meant as ultimate destruction, Christ has turned into an eternal reunion with our Creator and what he has for us in eternity. In death, Satan can no longer tempt. He can no longer trip us up. He can no longer try to lay claim to our lives and to our souls. Today, Alissa is eternally in the presence of Jesus, and there's nothing Satan can do about it. He is powerless. He can no longer get her attention. He can no longer test her soul forever. Now, Jesus is her sole focus. As parents, we wonder what choices our children will make, where they will go, who they will become. We lay out good plans in our minds, and they usually follow those plans until they become adults, and then they start doing things that really frustrate us. They quit doing what we think is best for them, and they start doing what they want or what they think is best, just like we did, and just like we did to our parents. Some of those choices cause us to celebrate and brag. Others cause us to wring our hands and fret. We celebrate because in our mind's eye, we can see where it will lead and where they could go in life. We fret because in our mind's eye, we can see where it will lead and where they will go in life. There are 11 words found in Scripture in the form of a proverb that can strike fear into a person's heart, or they can give an unending hope. And it's not easy to know how to hold on to those words until we're gathered in a place like this. Proverbs 16:1. We make our plans, but God has the last word. Is that a statement of threat, or is that a promise of hope? Are those words of warning or of promise, of caution or of assurance? For Alissa and for us today, those are words of comfort and hope. The same Creator that breathed life into her in December of 88 is the same Creator that took her soul back to himself in December of 21. Between those two points of life, a lot happened. She explored the world in more ways than we know, and in ways that pleased us, and in ways that concerned us. We gave God thanks for all of her successes, and we diligently prayed for her as she faced her challenges. All of those things, the good and the hard, took her to places to which we couldn't take her, and it took her to places from which we couldn't bring her back. She excelled in music. She reveled in her love of the outdoors, her love for her brothers and giving birth to her boys. She did all of this because of a drive that God had placed in her. She also went in ways of her own choosing because she desired to do something different than what God had planned for her to do. In all of that, the good, the hard, God never left her side. He never turned his back on her. He never said, when you're on the top of your game, I'll be there. And when you blow it, you're on your own, girlfriend. No, he kept saying, I'm not done with you yet. I'm not letting you go. You are mine. I will answer the prayers of others. I will not relinquish you to the powers and the devices that want something less for you. We didn't know all that he was saying to her. And we didn't know what all was going inside of her, going on inside of her. All that we knew was that he kept calling us to pray. We didn't know he was drawing her closer and closer to himself. We didn't know the plans he had for her. We just knew his plan for her, including us as a church, joining together as one voice, asking for his best to be accomplished in her life. One of the amazing things about God is that just when it looks like he isn't doing anything is precisely the time when he is accomplishing the most. In some of our minds, it was like God had went silent in Alyssa's life. We heard nothing. But that was probably because God was speaking so loud to her that everything else fell silent. In what seemed like a time void of his presence, he was the closest to her. In a time when it seemed all was lost was when everything was being gained. When we received the news that night that Alissa was fighting for her life, our hearts were heavy for you all as a family. But our hearts were heaviest for her and for her soul. We knew she had struggled. We knew she wanted to do right, but we knew the battle for her soul was strong too. We knew God had plans for her life. We knew she had laid out her own plans. But what we so often forget is the last part of that verse. But God has the last word. God has the last word. And whether we like it or not, what he has to say or not, his word is always good. It's always right, and it's always perfect. When Alissa became so desperately ill, so many questions popped into our minds, and we didn't know what to say. But there was one who wasn't at a loss for words. There was one who had yet to speak. There was no question in his mind as to what he was going to say. He knew it. He knew her life was short, and he was prepared to have the last word. He had spoken a lot to Alissa in recent months. They had had plenty of conversations. The words spoken between the two of them, we will never know. But somewhere in all of the goings back and forth between the two of them, Alissa finally said her final yes to Jesus. She decided no matter how hard the battle, she wasn't going to give in again. So when December 8th rolled around and the medical team was working feverishly to save Alyssa's life, Satan lost his final round for the battle for her soul, and God had the last word. Welcome home, dear child. Welcome home. And friends, that's why we can celebrate today. As sad as this is, that's why we can celebrate. Her life is a testimony to the goodness and faithfulness of God. It's only when one steps back and looks at the total picture of her life that one can even attempt to try to grasp the incredible love of the Father. In life and in death, he shows us that his love for us will never fail. And today we give him thanks that he has had the last word and he has welcomed her into his eternal presence. To him be all glory, all honor, and all praise.
We're going to sing, "I'll Fly Away." The words are printed on the bottom of the back side of that service order. Can we do this together? Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To a land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. The word after that on the service order says benediction. It's a Latin term. It means good word. There's a lot of people in our world today that think days like this are hopeless. And they wonder how any good word could ever be given when someone we love is no longer with us here. And the truth is, aside from faith in Jesus Christ, there is no good word to be given on days like this. However, because of Jesus, there is a good word. Because of Jesus, there's hope for all of us even today. Jesus is the one who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though they die." And Jesus said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me." And Jesus said, "In this world you'll have trouble." And he was right. "But take heart, because I have overcome the world." He overcame the world in Alyssa's life. And we give him all praise and glory. He's the benediction. He's the good word. He was the good word for Alyssa. And he can be the good word for us all. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks so much for coming today.
By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we've overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God would lead us to that blessed promised land. But he guides us with his eye, and we'll follow till we die, for we'll understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God
often take us unawares, and our hearts are made to bleed for a thoughtless word or deed. And we wonder why the test, when we try to do our best, but we'll understand it better by and by. Well, now, by and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we've overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. By and by, yes, we're